we are going to investigate one of the seven kingdom parables which Jesus taught in the book of Matthew, the parable of the woman and the leavens. Although we can apply parables and we hear them preached with an evangelistic slant, their primary purpose was to reveal kingdom truths to God's people. He personally gave these parables not only to reveal his truth to his disciples, but they were also given in parable form to conceal their meaning from those who were his opponents. It was not always for the Pharisees and the Sadducees to know and understand. So let us read in Matthew 13:33. Another parable spake he unto them, "The kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took, and hid in three measures of meal, till the whole was leavened." These parables in Matthew 13 were given in regards to the growth, development, expansion, and yes, even the corruption of the kingdom of God upon earth. Do not be confused because Matthew is talking about the kingdom of heaven. There is no distinction between the kingdom of heaven and kingdom of earth. Matthew was writing primarily to a people who would not use the name of Almighty God. So where Luke and Mark used one term, Matthew used another. Some people have tried to separate these expressions and build a whole doctrine upon them, but of course there is no difference. The very fact that these parables are paralleled by the other gospel writers proves these phrases can be used synonymously. Now the previous parable that Jesus spoke was the parable of the mustard seed, which dealt with the political, national, and material development of the kingdom. But in this verse, Jesus is turning attention to the spiritual and religious manifestation, conflict, and corruption of the kingdom of God upon earth. And we know that he is turning to the spiritual and the religious because he says that a woman took and hid three measures of meal until the whole was leavened. Right through prophetic scriptures, a woman always symbolizes a religious or theocratic or church system. We know right on through the scriptures, the word of God speaks of Israel as being his bride or wife of Almighty God. Sometimes she is a faithful wife, and sometimes she is an adulteress. At one time she was even cast out and given a bill of divorcement. But not in the last days. She is brought forth and made ready as the bride of the Lamb. Conversely, we know in Revelation 17 that the wicked apostate church system, headed up by Catholicism, is described as a woman draped in scarlet and purple, offering a golden cup full of abominations. She is the harlot and wicked beast system. Let's turn to Isaiah chapter 4 and verse 1 for an end-time prophecy. "And in that day seven women shall take hold of one man, saying, We will eat our own bread, and wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by thy name, to take away our reproach." And we know that this speaks of seven religious organizations or church systems who, while they want to be known as Christians and take the name of Jesus Christ, they want to wear their own apparel. They want their own worship, their own vestments, their own order of ceremonies and procedures. They want their own bread. They want their own false doctrines, but they still want to be called Christian. And we know among the seven are groups like Christian Science, Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, and Jehovah Witnesses. Now, having established that the woman represents a spiritual system which is going to attempt to corrupt the kingdom of God, let us look at the traditional explanation of the parable. We cannot build a house of faith and truth until we've cleared all the rubble out of the way to make room for the foundations. Now, what does the organized church teach that the parable means? Most evangelicals teach that the leaven represents the gospel. The woman is the church, and she is bringing the gospel to all peoples of the earth, through all generation, until eventually all of mankind is going to be brought to the knowledge of truth. We hear them preaching about bringing in the kingdom of God upon the earth by their own social gospel, worldly means, and the gospel of grace in order to establish the kingdom without the return of King of Kings. Is this true to fact? Is it possible we will eventually convert the majority of the world and establish the kingdom here upon earth? Not at all. It runs entirely contrary to everything the scripture tells us. As the scriptures are being preached more and more by means of worldwide communications, is the world getting better and better? Are things improving? Is society becoming more moral, more upright, more honest, more decent, more peaceful, more law-abiding? Not one bit of it. We know, matter-of-factly, society is becoming more and more corrupt. The scriptures themselves talk of the last days of man deceiving and being deceived. The scripture speaks of great falling away, an apostasy, and a departure from a revealed truth. In 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 3 and 4, scripture tells us, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables." Let us turn to Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 20. "Woe unto them that call evil good, and good evil, that put darkness for light, and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet, and sweet for bitter." In Luke chapter 8 and verse 8, asks if the true faith will even be found on earth when the Son of Man returns. There's going to be a lot of religion. There's going to be a lot of faiths. But will he find the one true faith that his apostles established? This is a true question God poses to us, and we cannot get around it. God says the whole world will wander after the beast and the harlot church that rides upon it. And only the faithful overcoming remnant will be holding to the truth in preparation for the coming of the King. So the traditional explanation of the parable runs entirely counter to the scriptures, and this is confirmed by the world around us. So let us look at the symbolism of leaven that is used in this verse. Now there is a fundamental law that we've discussed before, which is called the law of the first mention. The first time something is recorded, scriptures gives us the key as to what it's going to represent. So I want us to go way back to the book of Exodus, chapter 12 and verse 15 for the first mention. 7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread. Even the first day ye shall put away the leaven out of your house. For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel. In this verse, leaven was symbolic of evil, and it resulted in death. As we're going to see in the next several verses, there is no way that leaven could represent the pure gospel of Jesus Christ. Leaven is always taken as a symbol of evil, corruption, and degeneracy. So let us turn to Leviticus chapter 2 and verse 11. "No meat offering which ye shall bring unto the Lord shall be made with leaven, for ye shall burn no leaven nor any honey in any offering of the Lord made by fire." Let's turn to Exodus chapter 12 and verse 20. "Ye shall eat nothing leavened. In all your habitation shall ye eat unleavened bread." Leviticus chapter 6 and verse 17. Now this verse speaks of the offerings that Aaron and his sons were to make. They were told to make unleavened bread. "It shall not be baked with leaven. I have given it unto them for their portion of my offering made by fire. It is most holy, as is the sin offering, and as the trespass offering." And again in Leviticus chapter 10 and verse 12. "And Moses spake unto Aaron, and unto Eleazar, and unto Ithamar, his sons that were left, take the meat offering that remaineth of the offerings of the Lord made by fire, and eat it without leaven beside the altar, for it is most holy." It is clear to see that the Old Testament scriptures forbade the use of leaven in the offering unto the Lord in the tabernacle of Moses, and subsequently in the temple, because it was symbolic of evil and death, curse and corruption. Now the symbolism does not change as we move into the New Testament.